Earlier this year, I led a scientific expedition to St. Helena Island. It's one of the most remote inhabited islands on the planet. It's about halfway between Angola and Brazil, smack in the middle of the South Atlantic Ocean. And with no flights yet, the only way to get there is the same way they have for 500 years, by ship. It takes about 5 days each way from Cape Town. It is a fascinating and somewhat forbidding place. It's ringed with cliffs pretty much all the way around, and many of those have fortifications on top from the time when Napoleon was exiled there at the beginning of the 19th century. We went there to study the world's biggest fish, and also one of its most mysterious, whale sharks. These giant but peaceful animals visit St. Helena as part of incredibly long global movement patterns, and we wanted to know where they come from, what they're doing in St. Helena, and where they go when they leave. But while we were there, we took a break from our whale sharking activities and went to visit the one and only beach that they have in all of St. Helena. It's a black sand beach called Sandy Bay. And on the beach at Sandy Bay, here's what we found. All those little bits of white and blue and other colors standing out against the sand are pieces of plastic. But this isn't plastic discarded by the people of St. Helena. This plastic's got history. This plastic has traveled thousands of miles on ocean currents since being discarded by someone else, somewhere else. More recently, I had a chance to visit the Galapagos, again, to study whale sharks and all the other incredible life that makes its home in those islands made famous by Charles Darwin and the Voyage of the Beagle. And again, on Tortuga Bay Beach, in amongst those amazing marine iguanas, we found plastic. As a marine biologist, I came away from these experiences deeply conflicted. The discoveries that we'd made about whale sharks in St. Helena and the Galapagos were exhilarating, and so was seeing all the other amazing life in these very special places. But ever since I got back, these images of plastic on a far-flung beach have been a real mental splinter. They're a nagging reminder to all of us that even the remotest parts of the ocean are being affected by our actions here on land. It's quite a strange sensation to plan and carry out expeditionary research to very remote locations, only to find out that banal items like a drink bottle or a cigarette lighter or a plastic bag beat you there. When it comes to environmental problems, acute issues like the Deepwater Horizon oil spill are certainly very important, and they definitely attract the lion's share of media attention. But in the long run, it is the chronic problems that are the greater existential threat to the oceans. Things just like plastic pollution. I can't help but wonder what impact all those little bits of plastic have on the whale sharks that I study. Whale sharks are filter feeders. They make a living by separating plankton from huge volumes of water, and I'm all but certain that they ingest this stuff while they're doing it. But the truth is, I don't know yet what impact plastic has on the health of whale sharks, and scientists are only just beginning to unravel the impacts of plastic on other species. But what we do know is that the plastic problem in the oceans is getting worse. In a recent report, the Ocean Conservancy estimated that within 10 years, for every 3 pounds of fish that live in the ocean, there will be a pound of plastic floating around. And for many of the animals that make their home in the ocean, that amounts to death by 1,000 cups. Chronic problems like plastic pollution are incredibly important because of all of the things that the ocean does for us. This one globally connected layer of salty water that covers 70% of our planet serves us as a highway, a pantry, a pharmacy, a sewer. It's the very lungs of the earth. In fact, the ocean does so many things for us that it might very well be our very best friend. And yet, we don't know it very well. And in a lot of ways, we don't treat this friendship with the respect that it deserves. Let me share just a couple of the things that our friend the ocean does for us. There's an old saying that a true friend is someone who helps you move. And by that yardstick, the ocean is a very good friend indeed, because about 90% of global commerce takes place on the oceans. The majority of things that you and I touch every day were on a ship at some point, in either their raw material or their manufactured form, maybe even the seat that you're sitting on. The ocean is a pantry. It's the last significant remaining source of wild-caught food on the planet. About 3 billion people rely on the ocean every day to provide them with a significant portion of the protein that they need. It's been said that if it swims, wriggles, or oozes through the ocean, someone, somewhere, eats it. Coral reefs are the rainforests of the sea, or as marine biologists like to think about it, rainforests are the coral reefs of the land. A healthy coral reef is one of the most spectacular natural things you can experience, overflowing with color and more types of animal life than you can find anywhere else. And all of that diversity is a veritable goldmine of potential scientific discoveries, including the largest natural repository of pharmaceutical drugs that we can use in the fight against disease. The National Cancer Institute maintains a list of promising anti-cancer compounds, and right now, more of those candidates come from the ocean than anywhere else. Most people think the air we breathe comes from trees. That's only half right, because half of the oxygen, actually more than half of the oxygen in the atmosphere, comes not from majestic forests, but from tiny, single-celled planktonic algae that float around in the ocean. Untold billions of little green microorganisms are keeping you and I alive every day by providing half of the oxygen that's in your lungs at this very moment. So, if you don't believe the ocean's a good friend to you, try skipping every other breath. And finally, the ocean is doing us a huge favor by regulating and buffering our climate. Ocean current systems, like the Gulf Stream, play critical roles in redistributing the sun's energy from the equator towards the poles, which drives seasonal weather patterns that are essential for agriculture, bird migrations, little league games, and pretty much everything else. And ever since the Industrial Revolution, the ocean has absorbed a quarter of the carbon dioxide emissions and almost all of the heat that has been trapped by the greenhouse effect so far. We have a tendency to think about climate change as an atmospheric phenomenon, something that happens up there. But climate change is really about the oceans, every bit as much as it's about the atmosphere. So, hope I've convinced you that our ocean is truly a good friend to us, providing us with all kinds of benefits and favors, what scientists and economists like to call ecosystem services. But I think it's fair to ask, what kind of friend are we to the oceans? How well do we really even know this friend that does so much for us? I don't think we know as much as we should, and we definitely don't know as much as we need to in order to navigate the challenges of the coming century. How is this possible? How is it that in the 21st century, our knowledge is deficient about the dominant geographic feature on our planet? By contrast, earlier this year, NASA was able to send us back high-resolution images of Pluto, a dwarf planet that's more than 4 billion miles away from Earth. That is a truly staggering scientific achievement. And yet, we've still only documented a few percent of our own ocean floor. Well, in defense of marine scientists, NASA has a much bigger budget for exploration. But the ocean is also a challenging place to work. In many ways, it's just as challenging as space. And in a number of very important ways, it's maybe even more challenging than space. As a result of the difficulties of working in the ocean, our understanding of what the ocean is like is lacking, and public perception of the oceans is very, very biased. I want to give you a very simple example. I'd like you to hold in your mind, for just a moment, a mental image of an average bit of the ocean and what that's like. Just an average bit of the open ocean somewhere. While I show you what 94% of the ocean actually looks like. In fact, I already showed you. Are you ready? Looks like nothing. 94% of the ocean is a pitch black, formless void. That's because sunlight only penetrates about 2 football fields below the surface. The rest, about 11,000 feet on average, looks like this. Completely dark, 24/7, 365, apart from the occasional flash of bioluminescence. If you compare that with your mental image of an average bit of ocean, I'm willing to bet that they're different. And that's what I mean when I say our perception of what the ocean is really like is biased. But it doesn't stop there. The ocean's colder than you think, too. Beyond the reach of sunlight, it hovers just above the freezing point, everywhere. Doesn't matter if you're off the coast of Greenland or off the coast of Hawaii, the overwhelming majority of the ocean is in a state of frigid, perpetual darkness. There are two main reasons why our friend the ocean is so inscrutable to us. And it's not the cold and it's not the dark. The first is that you have to go there to see it. You can strap on a scuba tank and jump in. I like to do that. But the bit that you can see that way is less than 1% of the average depth. So if you want to get to know the rest, you have to use other methods. But they can't be remote methods, at least not in the NASA sense. When NASA sent that New Horizons probe to Pluto, it sent back its treasure trove of data by radio waves. And radio waves don't penetrate through seawater. So if you want to get to know the oceans, you really have to go there and see them. Sound, in the form of sonar, remains the best way to send and receive information underwater. And to be honest, from an engineering perspective, it's not very good at it. So if you want to get to know the oceans, you have to go there. You have to take a submersible, or you have to go out on a ship and take one of these tethered, remotely operated vehicles with you, but you have to physically go there. And that's when the second problem gets you. Because if you try to go there, the ocean will try to stop you, or even kill you. Undoubtedly, the most hostile aspect of working in the deep oceans is pressure. At the bottom of the deepest part of the ocean, that's the Marianas Trench off the coast of Guam, the pressure is more than 1,100 times what we're experiencing sitting in this room. What does that even mean? Well, it's about the same pressure that takes place for a split second in the chamber of a gun when a 357 Magnum round goes off. But down there, it's like that all the time. Ever since Malaysian Airlines Flight 370 went missing in 2014, it's the difficulty of working under those kinds of conditions that have made it so hard to find, to the surprise of everybody, it seems, except oceanographers and marine biologists. Maybe it's no surprise that we've only been to the bottom of the deepest part of the ocean in person precisely twice in human history, once in 1961 and once a couple of years ago. More people have walked on the surface of the moon than have been to the deepest part of our ocean. Blows my mind. We can't fully appreciate yet exactly how much our present and future existence on this planet depends on the health of the oceans because we just don't know them well enough yet. But what we do know suggests that we ought to cultivate this friendship a little bit better. The Senegalese conservationist Baba Diouf said, "We will only protect what we love, and we only love what we understand." We need to make an effort to understand everything that the ocean does for us in all of its magnificent complexity so that we might be better stewards of this fate that we're both going to share. We shouldn't shy away from the challenges of working in the deep ocean. We should embrace them as opportunities. There are fantastic chances waiting out there for us to explore and discover, invent things, solve problems, and inspire new generations of scientists, engineers, and leaders. There are acute and chronic problems facing the ocean, it's true. The good news is that science tells us the ocean is a resilient place. And the other good news is that we know what many of the solutions are already. It's really just a matter of implementation, activation energy, if you like. Based on what I saw in St. Helena and the Galapagos, if I could ask you to do one thing for the oceans today, it would be to cut down on plastic. Bring a cloth bag to the supermarket. Say no to the straw. Recycle. These are small, simple, easy, local changes in behavior. But if we all do them, they really can and they really will make a real difference to this problem that occurs because the ocean is downstream of everything else. If you're a business person, ask yourself what opportunities the ocean offers for business success while at the same time achieving lasting and positive environmental change. We need more solutions like this one. This is the Baltimore Trash Wheel, a solar-powered device that pulls plastic garbage out of rivers and streams before it ever reaches the sea. What a fantastic idea. There are markets for these kinds of things, and if we really set our hearts to it, we could fix this problem. If we're willing to invest a little bit of our time, some money, and a whole lot of creative energy in rebooting our relationship with the ocean, we should have a bright future together. There is no reason we can't continue to use the ocean to drive international commerce. We'll find ways to feed a growing human population through fisheries management and creative aquaculture. The search for drugs in the ocean can continue, and we will all be able to breathe a lot more easily if we can cut down on the carbon emissions and restore the balance between the ocean and the atmosphere. But we have to get cracking. The ocean cannot continue to take the hits for us forever. But if we can rise to these challenges, then I get to achieve my greatest dream, which is to leave to my kids an ocean that is as dark and cold and clean as they need it to be, and in the surface layers at least, also as blue and as beautiful and as brimming with life as they deserve. And I hope I'm not alone in having that dream. So let's embrace our friend the ocean while we still can. Thank you.